Well, first and foremost, I'm a filmmaker. I don't know whether I've ever formally trained in history. I mean, the last time I took a course in American history was 11th grade when they hold a gun to your head and make you take it. I've always wanted to be a filmmaker for almost as long as I can remember. My mother died of cancer when I was 11. There wasn't a moment when I wasn't aware that she was dying. After she died, my father, who had a very strict curfew for me and my younger brother, would forgive it if there was a movie late at night on TV, that even on a school night, that might go to 2 a.m. And I remember watching my father cry a couple years after my mother died. He hadn't died at her funeral, hadn't cried at her funeral. And I realized how much power there was in this world of filmmaking, and I became convinced that I was going to be the next John Ford or Alfred Hitchcock or Howard Hawks. Those are old American movie directors. And I went to college assuming that that would be the case, but all of my teachers at Hampshire College in Amherst, Massachusetts, in the fall of 1971 were social documentary still photographers who reminded me, I think quite correctly, that there's much more drama in what is and what was than anything the human imagination makes up. And it's only later that I realized that what I wanted to do was about American history, but it's completely, I'm completely untrained and untutored. Well, I remember being obviously very impressed with the nascent cinema verite movement. There was so much energy in it. And that would be John Marshall and Frederick Wiseman, I guess, would be the chief purveyors, Ricky Leacock. The ancient tradition of documentary goes back to Flaherty, and one always absorbs his thing. I particularly like a British director named John Grierson, whose Night Mail is one of my favorite films, a kind of more composed and formalistic documentary from the BBC. Perry Miller Adado made a film in the early 70s about Gertrude Stein called When This You See, Remember Me, that used actors to read on camera the words of the people, the characters in this biography of Gertrude Stein, and I was really fascinated. And in some way, my pioneering use of first-person voices to complement a third-person narrator was born in the inspiration I found in her very completely different work, but nonetheless very seminal and influential to me. But, you know, Orson Welles, the French New Wave, Antonioni, I think particularly my two favorite directors, or three favorite directors if I had to do that, would be Kurosawa, Buñuel, and Buster Keaton, and not necessarily in that order. Well, I think filmmaking is obstacles. In fact, every film is a set of millions, literally, no exaggeration, millions of problems. But I use the word problems not so much pejoratively as if it's just resistances, friction that you have to overcome. I'm 56 right now. I've been making films for over 30 years. I don't look 56. You can imagine what I looked like when I started off. And the first film I wanted to do was to tell the story of the Brooklyn Bridge. So people would slam the door and say, this child is trying to sell me the Brooklyn Bridge. No. And for many years, I kept two thick binders, three-ring binders of literally hundreds of rejections. So I guess the biggest sort of outer resistance was just finding the money to be able to produce these films that I wanted to produce, convincing people that even making a film on a bridge was worthy subject, that it was going to be hard to keep it at an hour when they couldn't understand why a film on a bridge shouldn't be a short that was 5 or 6 minutes in length. Inwardly, I think it was trying to find a form. I mean, a style that adheres to someone has to be an authentic process, and style is the authentic application of technique. And in my world, that meant trying to refine dozens and dozens of techniques to make the past come alive. And in my case, I guess for the purposes of simplicity and brevity here, I deal with 8 elements. 4 are oral and 4 are visual. The visuals are pretty obvious. The live cinematography, the interviews that we do, the newsreel footage, and the still photographs, in which I was most keenly interested in because of my training in still photography as well, in which I wanted to go into an old photograph, not just hold it at arm's length, as had been the want of my colleagues, but to live in it, to listen to it, what sounds were it making, to take that old desire to be a feature filmmaker and see each still photograph as a master shot that had a wide, a medium, a close-up, the possibility to tilt, to pan, to reveal, and to make the photograph come alive. Orally, We had a third person narrator, the voice of God, the sort of the traditional way that you communicated in documentary. But also I added first person voices read off camera by actors reading diaries, journals, letters, newspaper accounts of the period. And then a complicated sound effects track as complicated as a feature film that would hopefully help to will to life the still photographs and the archival footage we had. And a complex music track that was recorded not after the editing, but before. So the music became as organic as an element of as anything else. And that's what I needed inwardly, creatively, to figure out how to perfect or how to understand what the how the various elements would coexist before I could really call myself a filmmaker. You know, the advice that I give is always sounds so platitudinous because it isn't specific to the medium of film. It's totally specific to life. I'm in a medium in which people are attracted to it because they think it's glamorous, and only a small fraction of it is. It's mostly a lot of hard work. So I think the most important thing that I would say would be two things. One, you have to be true to yourself. That is to say, you have to know who you are, whether you have something to say or not. And it is no shame to honestly say, you know what, I don't think I have something to say. This isn't for me. Maybe I will help in this business in a subservient role, but I'm not going to be that director or producer or writer that I thought I was. There's no shame in that. So knowing yourself is the first critical thing, to be able to walk away. You should do, Emerson wrote a beautiful essay called On Self-Reliance. And in it he said you should do what only inly rejoices, I-N-L-Y. I think he was making up a word, inly rejoices. And I've always thought that that was true, and I would wish that for everyone. So despite how we are often, you know, attracted to fields that we think is going to be our discipline, or we're forced into by parents or by other circumstance, you have to do what inly rejoices, and you have to listen to that voice. And the second thing is you have to persevere, particularly in documentary film. If you wanted to be a doctor or a lawyer or a feature film, I could tell you the steps to take to do that. But every working documentary filmmaker I know has gotten there through their own unique path. There is no career path. That's the good news and the terrifying bad news. There's no career path, and you're alone, and you just sort of have to bring something to it. And what I think it is, among many other qualities, is a kind of perseverance. It's keeping and collecting those hundreds of rejections for your first film as a reminder that, you know, you may not be the most talented person. You may not have the best ideas, but you're going to see this through. And I'm sure there are lots of great filmmakers or people that would have been great filmmakers had they been able to follow through, that had ideas much more interesting than mine, but didn't, and therefore aren't filmmakers, and we don't know what they are because they didn't have that ability to persevere against the inevitable problems, the inevitable friction that attends any effort to create something new. You know, I'm not sure that this need to be new is in fact anything that's relevant. Some people, some artists, their breakthrough is newness. I suppose when I began, the coalescing of all of these elements was new. But the point is to be authentic. And so I'm not sure we've ever thought that we should go and do something new for the sake of being new. That's actually ridiculous and part of a kind of decadence of a society, of an art that always wants to be different, thinking that difference was anything better. It's not necessarily better. The National Parks was essentially the modulation of all the elements that go into our film. But it would be unique insofar as the main character would be the live cinematography, the all the magnificent parks that we've set aside in conjunction with a set of 50 or 60 historical figures who, like a Russian novel, existed in the foreground in front of that spectacular backdrop. And it was our great challenge to figure out how to organize the stories of the 50 or 60 odd people that we introduce you to, knit their narratives together into something that made a coherent narrative, all the while having this drama play out in front of, I would argue, some of the most beautiful places on earth. You know, I live in New Hampshire. We make maple syrup. It takes 40 gallons of sap to make 1 gallon of maple syrup. Boil, 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 evaporate, evaporate, evaporate. That's pretty much what documentary filmmaking is for me. It's about 40-to-1 shooting ratio, to footage shot to footage used. It varies in different films. On something like the national parks, it's going to probably be a lot more because you're spending a lot of time with live cinematography. But for every archival photograph you see, we've looked at 150 and shot 100 and, you know, had that possibility of putting in, you know, 40 times that much, 50 times that much in any other thing. And the cutting room floor, as I suggested before, is not filled with bad scenes. It's just scenes that didn't fit. You remember the movie Amadeus, a wonderful scene where the arrogant Franz Joseph says to Mozart, too many notes. You know, there's a truth to that. You just have to figure out what's gone. And if I showed you scenes taken out of the film, you'd think, oh, what an idiot. He's lost it. Why would he leave this out? But it had a destabilizing effect. And what you serve is a larger whole. Well, as I described before, I was interested in sort of willing these still photographs alive, to explore them with an energetic camera eye, to not hold them at arm's length, to bring them alive, to not only look at them and take them apart dynamically and put them back together in good storytelling fashion, but to listen to them and add complex sound effects, to add period music and first-person voices that would give you the sense, as William Faulkner once said, that history is not was, but is, that for maybe a fraction of a second, you might feel that you are not so much participating, but you could feel what it was like to be there, even with a still photograph.
When you're standing there silently in the presence of the giant sequoias, you can't help but recognize that you're a part of something that is way beyond whatever it is that you envisage this world might be.
And all of those complex things and thousands of other things I haven't told you about are what now gets reduced to a shorthand called the Ken Burns effect. Essentially, Steve Jobs called me up 6 or 7 years ago, I guess it was now, and asked me to come out to Cupertino, California. He and some classically nerdy technicians had been working on this thing called, which their working title was the Ken Burns effect, that allowed people who downloaded photographs to pan zoom or pan on them. And they had perfected it, and this was November, and every Apple computer from then on would have that as its basic software starting that January. And they wanted to keep the name, and I said I didn't do commercial endorsements. But we worked it out where they gives me equipment which I give to nonprofits, and I allowed them to use the name. And so all of a sudden it sort of seeps in the consciousness, and the Ken Burns effect for anyone who has an Apple computer is a part of the lexicon, and it's one of those classic examples where the technological tail is wagging the dog of a much more complex thing. But the spirit, Steve's spirit, was exactly right, that we don't want to have a relationship to images that is just at arm's length, that we want somehow to penetrate the proscenium, as we would say in theater, that get beyond the artificiality, the plasticity of imagery, into some moment that might have something that we could learn, in which 1 and 1 would equal 3, that if you put this image next to this image, that the combination of the two would be greater than the two images themselves. It's the metaphor, as I'm suggesting, all during this conversation, for life, for art, for what we're here for. It's what a scientist will tell you thereafter. Well, I think we've been surprised, certainly in a lot of the work that we've done, but particularly so in the National Park, by the amazing diversity of the story. This is not just a top-down history. I mean, most people think American history is just a series of presidential administrations punctured by wars, and that gives you a fairly, you know, I suppose, superficial handle on things. But it's much more complicated than that, and the bottom-up view that we've always tried to adopt delivers you much more complexity and undertow. It allows you to penetrate more fully into the number one sub-theme of American life, race, born as we were under the idea that all men are created equal, but the guy who wrote that sentence owned 100 other people, never saw the contradiction, never saw the hypocrisy, and more important, never saw fit in his lifetime to free any of those people, and set in motion an American narrative that in almost every way is constantly bumping up against this question of race. The Civil War, the most important event in our history, wouldn't have happened had slavery not existed in a country that was proclaiming to the world this new idea of individual liberty. So that's there, and diversity, naturally occurring diversity, is an important part of the films that we make. And in this one, to understand that the Buffalo Soldiers, the celebrated African-American cavalrymen of the late 19th and early 20th century, were the first park defenders in California's Sierra Mountains at Yosemite and General Grant, what was then called General Grant National Park and Sequoia National Park. And what an amazing phenomenon that in the first decade of the 20th century, a decade, by the way, when more African-Americans were lynched than at any other time in our history, that African-Americans might be telling other Americans what to do in a national park was interesting. And that complements the top-down, or the more top-down story of John Muir, this Scottish-born naturalist beaten by his father until he memorized the entire New Testament and three-quarters of the Old Testament, could find a new faith in nature that was utterly American, utterly transcendental, therefore, in wild nature, that he could dispose of the dogmatic devotion that the European tradition, worshiping cathedrals and representatives of God, meant, and could free himself and his countrymen, his adopted countrymen and women, by sharing a new faith in the mountains. And he is the most important prophet of not just the national parks, but the idea behind the national parks. And that's why we made the film. This is not a travelogue or a nature film per se. This is the history of individuals and ideas, and we say it's America's best idea, knowing full well it's provocative and challenging, but once you've started a country on the idea of individual liberty, you'd be hard-pressed to find a better idea than setting aside for the first time in human history land not for kings or noblemen or the rich, but for everybody and for all times. We invented it. It's an utterly American idea and could have only happened where people were struggling to figure out how to govern themselves, however flawed that original conception might have been. I finished a film on the Civil War in 1990, and a couple years later I was back at Gettysburg, which is a national park site, walking across the lawn of the visitor center with the superintendent. And he scooped down at one point and picked up a popsicle wrapper and waved it in my face and said, "It's all your fault." And what he meant was that his attendance had gone up 100, 200, 300% after my film on the Civil War and had stayed there. So I guess what I want is for every superintendent of every national park unit, and there are 392, to be mad at me because they've got people coming and they don't know what to do with them. And that's already happened. All of the things I want have already taken place. We had a huge tens of millions of viewers on public television. People are rearranging their plans to go to the national parks. And that in and of itself, without having a specific political agenda, will change the agenda of the United States with regard to parks. The parks have undergone years of neglect. The previous administration allowed upwards of $8 or $9 billion worth of maintenance, deferred maintenance, to take place. And we now have to go back and figure out where that money comes from and how to bring the parks back up to snuff and how to think about wild places for the 21st century. And that's a challenge which I think the parks reminded people that they were invested in. That, you know, you say you're working on the national parks and it's like, it doesn't sound so cool, and everybody assumes they've always been there. They haven't, and therefore that threatens them. They assume the National Park Service has always been there to take care of them. They haven't. They don't show up until 50 years into the existence of the national parks, and therefore they're threatened, and they assume they'll always be there. And if people believe that, then they are most definitely threatened. Because once you lose a place, it's lost forever. Once you've saved it, the saving is, like liberty itself, and it requires a kind of eternal vigilance. And I think that what we did was help reinstill some of our fellow citizens with that sense of the vigilance required. And in that case, it's already a success, and we've gotten what we've wanted. Well, I don't know what your definition of patriotism is, and mine is so complicated that it would take up some time. I do think that it is a form of patriotic expression. We have now come to use patriotism in the most superficial and politically isolating way. We use it to tar people whose opinions we don't agree with, or use it as a weapon to tell people why their opinions render them unpatriotic. That's not what I'm interested in. I think that for some reason or another, this combination of an interest in film and an interest in American history has also formed in me a kind of deep and abiding love, not without criticism. Every one of my films, because it deals with race, is implicitly critical of the United States and the path that it quite often takes. But at the same time, it understands something larger. I'm interested in listening to the voices of a true, honest, complicated past that is unafraid of controversy and tragedy, but equally drawn to those stories and moments that suggest an abiding faith in the human spirit, and particularly the unique role this remarkable but also sometimes dysfunctional republic seems to play in the positive progress of mankind. That's my creed, and I think that is a higher form of patriotism. The quirky appeal they might or might not appeal to others, or so-called buffs, as your question says, doesn't interest me at all. I'm interested in that complicated past. I'm interested in telling stories. The fact that my interests might intersect with others who are drawn to the Civil War is, I guess, good. But that's not what I need to focus on. All I'm trying to do is tell a good story. And telling a good story is an incredibly difficult and hard undertaking that requires the talents of a lot of amazing people that I have the good fortune to work with to do that. I'm not sure that your question is entirely correct. Buffs don't sort of attend to these films. It is true that there are Civil War buffs, and they find in my film and other books and other films that have been made a kind of re-energizing of their interests. But the films themselves exist quite above whatever superficial, sentimental, nostalgic relationship that so often buffs have. I'm disinterested in sentimentality and nostalgia. In fact, it's not only the enemy of good storytelling, it's the enemy of good history. I'd rather, though, not retire to a kind of rational world in which one and one equals two all the time. That's the safety of the empirical world, the rational world. All of us want, deep down, in some unexpressed way, for one and one to equal three. And it's that calculus that an artist pursues. It's that calculus that drives you, that improbable mathematical possibility that one and one could equal three is part of what we do. We say all the time that we wish the whole to be greater than the sum of the parts, but we don't really examine the difference between the sum of the parts and the whole. And that difference is what makes art art, which makes literature work, what makes us love, which compels the most important aspects of our lives. And that has nothing to do with buffs. I was interviewing for a film biography of Mark Twain more than 10 years ago, the novelist Russell Banks, and we were talking about Huckleberry Finn, which I believe, and he believed, was Mark Twain's most important novel. And he said, you know, it's our Iliad and our Odyssey, which really struck me. And he said, though most of us share the same European tradition that produced the Iliad and the Odyssey, we Americans were grappling with two new themes that our European ancestors weren't. And so we required a new Iliad, a new Odyssey, to help us grapple with these. And Twain alone among writers and philosophers and politicians of the 19th century knew and understood and was willing to deal with and entwine these two themes. One was race and the other was space, not outer space, but the physical geography of the United States. I don't go looking for race in my films. It's just there. You can't scratch the surface of the most important event in American history, the Civil War, without coming up, of course, against the question of race. You can't deal with the story of baseball, another great subject, without understanding that its finest moment is when Jack Roosevelt Robinson, the grandson of a slave, made his way to first base at Ebbets Field on April 15th, 1947. It's about race. That so much of the biographies that we've done on Thomas Jefferson, on Mark Twain, on Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Susan B. Anthony, on Lewis and Clark, on Jack Johnson. Inevitably, I don't know a film, with the possible exception of Frank Lloyd Wright, that didn't engage race in some way or another. Not because we went looking for it, but because we had committed as we were to dealing with not a superficial portrayal of a certain event in American history, it had found us. And so race is always there. The space is a different thing. The physicality of the United States works on us in ways we're so unaware. First of all, we have this magnificent continent, particularly the western part of the United States, which has been a draw to people from all over. But we're also, because we are a democratic society, or our society trying to be democratic, experience the freedom of movement at all class levels. Traditionally, movement was of armies or of the very rich in Europe and in other situations, that a family in a feudal situation could stay for hundreds and hundreds of years on the same spot. But in America, even the lowliest worker could travel, and did. And the national parks become part of the verifying of that co-ownership of the idea of America as well as the physicalness of America. So we're always bumping into a question of race. We're always bumping into this question of the physicality, the space of the United States. And it was nice to have someone as brilliant as Russell Banks, a great, great novelist in his own right, deliver it to us in such an easy, understandable thing. But he was essentially describing what has engaged my energies for 35 plus years. That's a great question. You know, most documentaries, at least when I were growing up, were sort of like castor oil. They were good for you, but hardly good tasting. They were just telling you what you should know. They were the expression of an already arrived at end, not a process of discovery. I don't pick subjects because I know about them. I pick subjects because I want to know about them. So my films are not me telling you what you should know, but saying, hey, guess what I learned? There's a huge, big difference. There's a subtle ingredient of enthusiasm that is a part of that, an excitement of the new story, that which is not known. Harry Truman once said, the only thing that's really new is the history you don't know. And for me, each of the subjects is something I want to delve into. It's like the mysteriousness of diving into the deep end and not knowing precisely how deep it is, and then coming back to report that. That's what we've tried to do with each film. And rather than be this sort of dull didactic expression of a set of facts and dates and events you should know about, it is rather an emotional archaeology that is the glue, I hope, that cements all of those dry dates and facts and events together into something higher, in which the whole is indeed greater than the sum of the parts. And it's that, again, calculus that I am so interested in. So every project is a learning curve. Every project is about that excitement of something new, that the little town of Winchester, Virginia, changed hands 72 times during the Civil War. We don't think of America as a place where armies would capture and recapture. That's Europe. But that happened in Winchester, Virginia. That the state of Missouri sent, I think it was 37 regiments to the Battle of Vicksburg, 21 for the North and 16 for the South, to show you how the country was torn on the bias. That Jack Johnson, who many people think is just this big brute of a man that needed the liberal helpers to get him through his life, has three patents with the United States Patent Office because of the tools that he designed to adjust the fast cars he liked to drive, that he was a great writer. I mean, everything comes with a blizzard, a flurry of new things that you learn, and that's the great excitement. That's why you do it. That's why you get up in the morning. You know, people ask me that all the time. I don't think my life is worth it. I'm a medium. That is to say, you know, if this is the 19th century, I'd be the guy holding the seance, you know? That's, in essence, what I'm doing. I'm going back into the past, and I'm trying to interpret all of this random stuff into something that may make sense for me, and I hope other people, because we share some things in common, I trust, I hope. But my own life doesn't seem that important. there are people who always want to make it so, just as the life of painters seem interesting to us, or architects, or other artists. I don't feel so that way. I mean, in fact, the most important thing to me in my life is not my filmmaking anyway. It's I have three daughters who are range in age from 27 right now to 4 years old, and I'm much more concerned with that co-production of being a father than I am with the films, and that's something entirely different and obviously private. I actually think it's probably in the service of good storytelling. There's a phrase that we use often when we're writing and when we're editing about give and take away, that too often what we've used in our view of history, or maybe another way of saying is, too often our view of history is a sanitized Madison Avenue view of things, in which we've reduced complex human events, which was all a human event, into something that's simplistic. We superimpose something that's so easy to figure out. But it's much more interesting to understand the undertow. It's much more interesting to understand the darker sides of a character, the negative sides, the vices as well as the virtues. And what that then does is attune your ear in storytelling to the power of contradiction, to the power of irony, as you suggest. And that is often a driving engine of good storytelling. It isn't just always action, but it's often who comes to that action and their complexity. And I've always been drawn to that since the very, very first film, and I think that's an element of good storytelling. You know, when somebody says, "How was your day, dear?" you don't say, "I backed the car slowly down the driveway, missing the garbage cans at the curb, pulled into the street, drove up to the stop sign, put the blinker right, and turned into traffic." You don't say that unless you get hit by a car the second you turn into traffic. That's storytelling. Well, you know, there's no response to that. People will always do something different if left to do it. They haven't done it. A critic hasn't done it. There's not a statue to a critic anywhere on earth, which proves a little bit about how easy it is to criticize. The more important thing is that the universe is chaos. Chaos, random chaos. There is a disinterested God, but it is chaos. Nobody's directing our misfortune or our good fortune, which belies why baseball players look up to heaven when they hit a home run. I don't know why they don't do that when they hit into a double play. They don't, but they somehow think someone's watching over them when good things happen. The universe is chaos. And what we human beings do to keep from going crazy, because none of us get out of this alive, is to superimpose narrative, complicated narrative, over that. That's storytelling. But it's all subjective. Everything is subjective. What I will collect for a film on jazz is different than what the jazz critic thinks a film on jazz should contain. I also have to actually do it, physically make the film, not abstractly think about it. So I know, for example, that there's not a single viewer that'll ever watch a film about jazz that's an encyclopedia or a dictionary or the telephone book. You have to actually decide which stories you're going to tell, which stories are signal and emblematic, and tell those and only those, knowing full well that there is a huge negative space of creation. It's like the sculptor who's delivered to her studio a big block of stone, and she chips away at it, and on the floor is the rubble, the negative space of creation, which she is more than anyone else aware of. So we don't leave anything out. It's just stuff has to be left out in order to tell a good story. You cannot put everything in. So then that makes you susceptible to people who think, "Oh, where's the guy that should be in?" or "I wouldn't take this." Or sometimes mistake the complex emotional archaeology for nostalgia and sentimentality, which it's not. Sometimes people find the principal emotion of those higher emotions is love. And love is a very embarrassing and complicated word for a lot of people. They decide early on whether they deal with it or can deal with it. It's usually reserved for the person they're married to and their children, and that's about it. But love is actually the ingredient of the universe. It's the quantity that makes things work. And so if you deal with love, as I do, as the ultimate theme underlying all stories, it's a form of communication, but also of love, that can make some people pretty nervous. And so I can get dismissed all the time as being sentimental and nostalgic, which I'm not. But you understand why, because it is so frightening to be talking about love. American history is neither cyclical or progressive. There is an attempt in our desperate need to superimpose some order into the random chaos of things to see things as cyclical or to see things as getting better. But in fact, human nature is the only given here. It's always the same, and it's got some very, very complicated things. The fact that we detect patterns is only because human nature is so much the same. Our warlike tendencies. That means there is no hope that wars will disappear until human beings disappear. That's what we'll do. We hope it won't be true, but it's part of the nature, and it's going to take some real evolutionary progress before that isn't the case. That people will fall in love, that they will be sexually attracted to other people inconveniently as well as conveniently, that will always be true. That people will, some people will always crave a kind of power over other people, that other people will accept power imposed on them by others is also true. So that we can recognize cycles in American history. We can see a progressive movement, but at the same time, what it is just a series of events into which it becomes the artist or the historians or the combination of both's attempt to find some sort of narrative form on that, either through a life or through a series of lives, through an event like a war, the Civil War, Second World War, and to try to find something meaningful. I mean, that's all it is. I think it was Tolstoy who said that art is the transfer of emotion, I would say love, from one person to the other. So let's just say emotion, so it doesn't get half your audience terrified about the word love. That if it's the transfer of emotion from one person to another, what is that about? It's almost a kind of courage. It's almost a saying, look, Cézanne painted Mount Saint-Victoire, the mountain outside of his small town's bedroom window, and he painted it over and over again as if to say, here, let us find some steady place that we can know and to see its luminosity, to see it in different seasons, to understand it. It was the thing he returned to and again, and I sort of feel like I've made the same film over and over again. Each one asks the deceptively simple question, who are we? Who are those strange and complicated people who like to call themselves Americans? What does an investigation of the past tell us about not only where we've been, that's history, most people think, but where we are and where we're going? Because in point of fact, history, the past is gone. We're never going to get it back. And those who want to get it back, the buffs, are nostalgic and sentimental. That doesn't work. But history is the set of questions we in the present ask of the past. And so it is informed very much, subtly or not so subtly, by what we fear, what we love, what we wish for, what we're anxious about. And therefore, history, paradoxically, is very much about now and very much about the future. You can't have a future unless you know where you've been. You can't even have a present unless you know the sequence of movements that brought us to this present. In the 35 years that I have been sort of professionally making films, the technological change has been enormous. We have resisted it as much as possible. We didn't move to digital editing for 10 or 15 years after most of my colleagues had done so. We liked the tactile feel of cutting film, of taping it together. And I did not begrudgingly move to it. It's helpful in so many ways, digital editing. But I did so out of concern for the interns, the unpaid interns who came. Because for a long while during the 90s, it was sort of a badge of honor for them to learn how to use rewinds and editing machines, analog editing machines. But after a while, I realized that asking these interns to do this was like asking someone who wanted to be a race car driver to first learn how to shoe a horse. And it was just too anachronistic. And so we sort of came into the 21st century. We still shoot on film, though it's been proven to me by George Lucas personally that there's no difference that I could tell. We still sort of love the discipline of film, the terror. We've been speaking now for almost an hour with a tape that didn't need to be changed. In 60 millimeter, you have to change every 11 and a half minutes. And it's very expensive. It's not reusable. You could probably decide that this is a completely worthless conversation and erase it and start over on the memory card. But you can't do that in film. And that creates a kind of urgency, a kind of terror, in a good sense of that word, which we still like. We like to feel, you know, like we have to sit up straight and be on the edge of our seats to try to get something out of the person we're interviewing, or the person, or the scene that we're shooting, or the archive that we're engaged in. That's an exciting process. So we've both resisted it and reluctantly welcomed new technological change. You know, it's often said that the digital revolution that puts a DV camera in everyone's hands makes everyone a filmmaker. It's bullshit. It's bullshit. What makes somebody a filmmaker is somebody who knows how to tell a story. And telling a story, I'll tell you, I've been doing this for a long time, almost 40 years that I've been trying to tell stories with film. And I still feel like a student. I still feel like I'm learning what a good story is, or how to tell a story, or a new way to approach a story. And that means that it requires a kind of lifetime of devotion. It isn't enough just to be there when something happens. It isn't enough just to record whatever happens. We have to be storytellers. And it's just logical that only a few of us are going to be able to do that. And even do it in sort of flawed ways. I don't consider myself that great a storyteller. I'm learning. The key is listening. A lot of people come with a set of questions and then they can't get off that set of questions if they hear something new that you could follow a tangent that might give you something. And I think the most poignant time occurs when you're talking to someone who experienced war, because that's life at, paradoxically, at its height. When your life is most threatened, when violent death is possible at any second, life is vivified, lived at a level we don't experience even in sex or in love or in anything that our normal life delivers. And so war is one of those paradoxical human experiences that delivers us a sense of life lived at its top. And so that's what we're trying to get out of people that we interview about wars. And I remember in our film about the Second World War called The War, I asked a gentleman who was sort of holding me at arm's length, understandably, because his experience had been so bad. I suddenly said to this person who was no longer 85 or 86 years old, but back to being 19 years old, I just said, I didn't even ask a question, I just said, you saw bad things. And all of a sudden the lips started to quiver and the cheek twitched, and he began to tell me, not the sort of practiced, defended view of the war, but something much more complicated, something that revealed its horror. He had watched men die. He had killed men. He had seen it firsthand, and suddenly it was like passing through some door, some portal into his life and his experience that I feel privileged, but only because I watched the potential emerging of a 19-year-old soldier in France in 1944 and 1945, suddenly willing, perhaps for the first time, to share some of that horrible, gruesome thing that we need to know about if we're going to know anything about the human condition.